you've never had those questions in your heart, just live a little. You'll see. God, where are you? Have you ever wondered why bad things happen to good people? Ever wondered? If there's a God in heaven and we're his children, washed in the blood, why in the world would bad things happen to good people? How many know stuff happens to us? We're not immune from anything on this planet. Amen. So, Lord, we just ask that you speak to us in the name of Jesus. Open our hearts to hear your word, your voice. Help us understand. Lord, we just come with childlike faith, not pretending that we know it all, have it all figured out. We're willing to learn from you, Lord. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, that you reveal to us more and more each day, precept upon precept, line upon line. To you be the praise and the glory. Our hope, our faith, our trust is always in you. Be glorified in Jesus' name. Amen, 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 amen. Anybody happy in the house? It's Wednesday. Amen. Hallelujah. They tell me snow is going to be gone for a while. You're glad you didn't get anything like New York and so forth. And then they didn't actually get what they thought they were going to get. They got spared. And we had a little touch of that these last few days, but I see the sun is out. I'm always glad for sunshine. Amen. I'm looking for sunshine even when it's raining. If you've ever flown, you know, I don't know if you've ever left the runway sitting in a plane and it was raining and it's cloudy and it's miserable, but that plane takes off nevertheless. And boy, it doesn't take a few minutes when it pushes through the clouds and right up above, boy, it's sunshine, it's beautiful. And you kind of feel sorry for those underneath down there. And you know, I believe that's how it is for a child of God, that even though we're in this world, we're not of it. We don't allow the things to affect us like it does other people, because we're a different breed of people. We're kind of peculiar. How many know you're kind of peculiar, you know? People look at you funny. Well, it's because you kind of are different. You speak different. You look different. There's a glow about you, so they wonder. Right? Peter says, what did he say? You're a royal priesthood, a holy nation. You believe that about yourself? Amen. That's what God calls you. So I'm going with what he says, not how I feel. How many know your feelers can lie to you? It's not always accurate. There's days when I woke up or get up in the morning and I've said it, I don't feel like myself. Well, that doesn't change anything. I'm still me. Just because I don't feel like me, I'm still me. When I look in the mirror, there's no somebody else show up. That'll freak me out. Imagine you go look in a thing and it's somebody else. Woo, run, brother. It's you. Tell somebody to say, it's still you. You're going to make it. You're going to be okay. It's going to be all right. Go with me to the Bible, to the Word of God in our foundation scripture for today. In Psalm 13, this is kind of interesting. He's asking a question, says, how long must I struggle? Somebody say struggle. Now, how many know this is not the prayer or the cry of a heathen? But the psalmist says, how long must I struggle with anguish in my soul and with sorrow in my heart every day? I mean, it's just not on weekends or leap year. This is every day. How long must I struggle? Wow. With anguish in my soul. With sorrow in my heart every day. How long will my enemy have the upper hand? How many's ever felt that's going on? Where it seemed like the enemy has the upper hand. I'm struggling to breathe. I'm struggling to make it. Get above water. May you say to somebody here that think this doesn't happen to God's people, welcome to the planet. Welcome to planet Earth. we're not in heaven yet. Amen. And so, in verse number 5, can we go there? He says, but I trust in your unfailing love. Did you just hear what he said? How long is my struggle going to be? How long the anguish and my heart and my soul? But I trust. That's the turning key right there. No matter what I face, yet I trust in your unfailing love. My goodness. Lord, help us to receive that. That word in our hearts. And he says, I will rejoice because you have rescued me. Father, I speak that word of faith over your people today. That for some, Lord, we're in a struggle, we're in a fight. Our soul is vexed. Things come at us from every angle. And we have cried that prayer, Lord, how long? Where are you, God? When will I see deliverance? When am I coming out? Because I'm a believer, I'm a child of God, your word, it's full of promises. But yet, I will trust in your unfailing love. Oh, because my heart, you have rescued me. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Man, I could just, we'll just go home right now because that thing just preached to us, isn't it? Close the book and we'd be ready, fed, ready to go, man. But I want to talk about that tonight. Can we just be real tonight and take the band-aid off and actually face the thing, open the closet, look at the skeleton. Don't be afraid. Nobody's running out. I mean, you know, there come days where you're just going to have to face reality. I mean, it's pretty cool when Christians, you know, you speak Christianese to one another. Hallelujah. That's pretty cool, but you know, come on, let's be real. Let's just be real. You're going to face some things in this life. Jesus said, didn't he say, in this world, there'll be trials and tribulations. And we're going to talk about that. Is it okay if we talk about it? Oh, yes. Matter of fact, I want somebody to go while I'm getting ready. I want somebody to go in 2 Corinthians when I ask you to read it. Please read it. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Kind of just hang out there for me. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. But as we look at these scriptures tonight, is it okay if I just kind of relax a little bit? Hang out. We just kind of gather in the living room and just kind of hang out together. We talk a little bit. If somebody gets way too excited, we'll let the ushers kind of calm them down, you know. You know that's not going to happen, right? We love to get excited about the things of God around here. By the way, is it who's the first time maybe tonight here with us? Your first time tonight to be with us? Here's a handsome young man right here. Michael, God bless you, sir. Give the Lord a hand for Michael. He's with us today. God bless you. Bless you, sir. Bless you. Anyone else? Anyone in a long time? Yeah. Beirush. Good to see you, buddy. No, sir. No, sir. I'm glad you're here, man. Yes, sir. Oh, he couldn't make it. Can I tell on you a little bit? The job that he had, he was unable to come on Sundays and was sharing with us that he really wanted to be here on Sundays. He came on Wednesdays and with the guys out there. Just amazing testimony of what God's doing. Would you know the Lord changed things around for him so he's now able to come on Sundays and be with us? Give the Lord a praise for that. God's good. God's good. Yeah. Yes, sir. Amen. Amen. So, as we think about these things, I want to talk tonight about some real struggles that, believe it or not, Christians face. Not just the heathen, not just those out there, even Christians. We're not immune from any of this. We're going to talk about adversities. We're going to talk about struggles. Is that okay? I don't want it tonight. Of course, it's not going to be a downer. Oh, we're going to talk about struggles. No, I just want to ask the Holy Spirit, where do we live? Where, you know, we can put the band-aid on, but people still hurting. And we want to get to the bottom of it. And we want to answer by the word of God some questions. Is that okay? You're not afraid to open the closet a little bit? To get to the real thing, face the giant head on? Amen. So as we look at it tonight, not only are we going to talk about those things that are real, but we're also going to look at a sovereign God, totally awesome God, that in the midst of what we're going through, he's right there in the middle of it. Yeah. He hasn't and will never abandon us. You're never alone. He's with you. Just remember that. He did say, didn't he? I will never leave you. Never forsake you. That you can take to the bank. I think we'll all agree that in this world there's suffering, there's pain. You're going to face some things. Even as Christians, even as good Christians, because we think certain people don't, they never go through anything. You got to be kidding me. Just because they don't wear it on their sleeves and, you know, the attitude toward that thing. Faithful people, matured Christians, sincere people, beautiful Christians, those that sing hallelujah, those that can speak, you know, Christianese, as we said. They got it all together seemingly. But I'm here to tell you that even they go through great suffering sometimes, great pain. The apostles of old, how many know every one of them have suffered severely? Peter, according to historians, and Josephus, was crucified upside down. How many know that's kind of tough, being a follower of Jesus, right? The prophets, Jesus spoke about this. The teachers, the pastors, they go through things. If you go to the book of Hebrews 11, that's kind of the faith chapter, and you just begin to read, and you get to some of the latter portions there where he says, people were sawn in two, cut in half, brutally beaten, brutally, I mean, just, my goodness, for the name for the sake of Jesus Christ. And they refuse to deny their faith. It's a powerful, powerful scripture. And so as we look at that tonight, I want you to kind of help me take notes. So my question then tonight, in this forum, in this sanctuary tonight, God, where are you when I'm going through these things? Because I get those questions all the time. Where was God when this and that and the other happened? Was it his fault? Did he allow it? Did he send the thing to you? Kind of quiet out there. It makes me nervous. And so together tonight, we're going to discover, okay? We're going to go on a journey. And if I look at some things, and I'm going to get you to do some scripture, but I think of different things, and I think of man-made problems or pain. There's some stuff man has caused. You talk about wars going on. Right? You talk about the violence, the anger, the abuse, prejudice going on. That's man stuff. The evil in man's heart. Come on, crime. Shootings every day around us. Nashville. Man-made. There's an influence there, but man is the agent, or he's the one doing this. And then you think of natural disasters. I mean, there's so much going on in our world. Right? Hurricanes, tornadoes, come out of blue, floods, fires, volcanoes. I mean, you think of stuff that happens, and it's very destructive, right? Talk to the Floridians when it's hurricane time, or down during the time of Katrina, Louisiana, or the earthquakes happening up in California, and you just go around the country, look at what they just snowstorms and blizzards and all kind of craziness going on. These things happen, and there are Christians everywhere. You would think, since we are saved, we are born again, children of God, these things should not happen anywhere close to us or around us, but they do, don't they? Where is God in all of this? You may have a question. Is the Bible even relevant? Can we still hold on to this truth? See, I'm not afraid to talk about these things because I know this will stand the test of time. I don't have to run and defend this thing with a sword and a fight. No, it'll stand itself. It'll fight itself. Amen. So when you look at all these things, I notice, you know, if this is your favorite person and program, God bless you. But I just see it, and I call it like I see it. They had a little program, and Sister Oprah had her. had her spiritual advisor, her pastors, and this couple was there advising her and telling her. And let me quote from what they said on her program. And she was just all, oh my goodness. He said, Christianity is irrelevant. This is their pastor, her pastor now, her spiritual advisor. Christianity is irrelevant if it continues to quote letters from 2,000 years ago. Those are the folks that's going to advise you? I'd throw them out the studio, said, get out of here. Amen. This is what we live. I mean, this is, if we don't have the word, what do we have? Scripture does tell us too, heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will always stay. It's going to be here forever. It's not irrelevant. My goodness, it's more relevant today than ever before. This is our roadmap. This is what we live by. Oh, hallelujah. And I don't apologize for that. Come on, somebody give the Lord a hand for his word. Give the Lord a word for hand for his word. Lord, your word is needed now more than ever. And we give you praise. Now, we know there are people struggling. Whenever things happen to us, good people, believing people, I've met some people on the road and pastors and leaders of churches and just, you know, laymen and whatever, wonderfully saved and they love the Lord. But I've also seen when disaster hit, their faith is shaken. They start asking questions. God, where are you? And it's if to blame God for the disaster that we go through and that we're in. How many know that stuff is happening? Many have given up on God. They've given up on their faith. They've walked away. Start blaming God for when other Christians are mean and ugly and churches and pastors and different things like that. And we turn and say, but, you know, if that's God, if that's... God had nothing to do with the ugly that people do. God is a good God. He's always good. There's no evil in him. He cannot do wrong. Okay? So tonight, please, I ask forgiveness on behalf of those that has hurt you. Because we do serve a mighty and awesome God. Anybody found 2 Corinthians chapter 5? I want you to read from verse 6. Is there somebody in the audience? I want it to be heard also. Let me get this one, brother. This one takes a moment, doesn't it? Back here. Okay, maybe pull it down just a little. Let me get back here.
Just one verse.
5 and 6.
2 Corinthians 5, verse 5 and 6. Therefore, we are always confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Did I start too late? Was I supposed to
read
the verse?
No, go ahead to 8. You okay, 7 and
8. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord.
If we look at that again, we're going to see that verse number 5, if you will.
Now he that hath wrought us for the selfsame thing is God, who also hath given unto us the earnest of the Spirit.
So we are always, while we are at home in this body, or while we are confident, even though we know that, as long as we live in these bodies, somebody say these bodies. Talking about this body right here. You're absent from the Lord. Touch somebody next to you. If you feel somebody next to you there, that means you're here, right? You're not with the Lord, you're here. Right, you know, oh, you got problems, brother. Nobody beside you. You're going to have to reach back there and just grab Zalas. If you can touch somebody next to you, you know they're still here. They're with us, right? They're not with the Lord. And that's kind of you know, I hate to bust your bubble. It's kind of sad because that you're here. You're not with the Lord. And that means when you're here, you're going to face some things. If you were with the Lord, hallelujah, right? But since we are in these bodies, he says we're absent from the Lord. We're not with him. We are here. And once you, while you are here in this fleshly body, in this tent, if you will, or the glove, if you will. How many know this is just the glove or the tent? The real me, you can't really see the real me. You're going to have to look through the eyes of faith. The real me is amazing, is awesome. So until then, you're just going to have to put up with this, right? You're just going to have to put up with this. Because we one day we're going to be like him. We're going to see clearly. It's going to be all amazing. But while you're in this body, somebody say this body. Touch it. Touch that body next to you and yours. Come on, this body. This body, this body, this body, this body. You haven't arrived yet. This is not it. You will be given another body. A new body. One that'll never know sickness. One that'll never know disease ever, ever, ever. One that's going to be with the Lord forever. Whoa, glory. Huh? One that'll never grow old. Yeah, I heard a good hallelujah. Come on. So you're going to have to handle and be stuck in this one for a while. But one of these days, come on, tell somebody, one of these days, in the twinkling of an eye, woo, I don't know if somebody believes this or not, it's going to be in a flash, in a moment, we will be changed. Hallelujah. But while you are in this body, and I'm sorry, we're just going to have to do the best we can in this body. While you're away from the Lord, you're absent from the Lord, you're in this one. You haven't arrived yet. It's not the end. It's not over. It's not, you know, there are certain people who believe this is it. My life on earth, when you die, is like a dog. You just bury him and it's over. No, sir. When you bury a Christian, he's just about to begin, right? Christians never die, by the way. Amen. Did you know that? My father always preached, he said, don't believe the newspapers when they write, George McGregor has died. He says, don't believe them. Christians never die. They step from one life into another life with Jesus. Goodbye, world. Hello, Jesus. How many know that's how it's going to be? When you close your eyes here, you'll be with the Lord. To be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. There's no, he didn't stutter, did he? There's no comma in between. There's no, you know, no. To be absent from this one is to be present there. Oh, my goodness, that's hope for us. But, while you're here, while you're in this one, I don't want you to get all angry and upset, bent out of shape and lose your testimony, lose your cool, you know, walk away from God. All when stuff happens to this body, because it will. And I, you know, I'm not going to give you a little packet of seven steps and have all the answers thrown out. Perhaps as the Lord will, we may have to redig and find and search together and see what Scripture says. Amen? Our opinions really don't really matter. It's what God's Word says. We always want to refer back to this book, our manual, our roadmap. Hallelujah. Is anybody listening tonight? So while in this body, we're absent from the Lord. But soon we're going to be leaving this place. I want you to have hope. I don't know where you are, what you're going through. But we're going to lay this one down. We're going to get us a brand new one. And that one will never die. That one's going to live forever. And it'll be in a twinkling of an eye. There's no long process waiting. It's going to happen for you and I. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In this one, there's struggle, there's pain, there's sickness. You get tired. You get weary. There's struggles. There's people you're going to have to deal with. I want you to go with me to Psalm 103 from verse 15. Is it 14 rather? Yeah, you're right, 14 and 15. For he knows how weak we are. That's pretty plain. God knows. While you're in this body, we're weak. Amen. And he says, he remembers we are only dust. And you thought you all that in a bag of chips. He just called you a bag of dirt. You just dirt, man. You just dust. You know? You throw a little lipstick on it, maybe, you know, we're going to help that dust out a little bit, or just comb your hair or something. But he said, he remembers, God knows that we are weak. He knows that we are but dust. He made us. He ought to know that. Okay? And then he goes on, and our days on earth are like grass. How many realize that? Our days on earth, they're not forever. And I tell you what, I don't want them to be forever. Not in this body. When I see what disease does to people, when I see what sickness does, when I visit hospitals, when I'm on the mission field and I watch leprosy and I watch people suffering and dying, I say, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. When I see the atrocities, the abuse, the pain, and what the enemy does to people, I don't want to be in this one. I'm very clear. I don't want to be in this one 300 years and 500, not with this stuff going on. That's why he says, look up, for your redemption draws nigh. Something better. Something better. Tell somebody, there's something better waiting for us. There's something better. Friend, if there was not something better, we're all doomed and miserable. But there is something wonderful and better waiting on us. And so there's a hope. Hallelujah. Jesus could endure the cross because of what he saw, looking forward. Isn't that wonderful? We're looking forward. We don't look behind us. We're looking for a bright new day. And so he says to us in Psalm, my goodness, you know, yeah, we're like the grass of the field. And there are numerous scriptures that talk to us about that. Our days on earth, you know, like the grass of the field here today, gone tomorrow, like the smoke, vapor. And so forth, you know, and it's and we know that. We know that. There's no guarantee of us, you and I, waking up in the morning. There's no guarantee. I'm telling you, my pastor used to preach, old Paul Baggett. I don't know if everybody know him, but he'd say, you may have tied your shoelaces, put them on in the morning, but an undertaker may take them off tonight. That's how fragile life is, friend. Hallelujah. Proverbs 27 says, boast not thyself of the day of tomorrow, for you don't know what that day will bring. We just don't know. So every moment that you have, make it count. Don't think about, oh, I'm going to one day do this for the Lord. One day, no. Every moment is precious. Be in the moment. Think of now what you want to do for God. Today is the day of salvation, not next week. You may not have next week. So when you feel the tug of God in your heart, respond now. Hallelujah. Life is short, but eternity is long. Say that with me. Life is short, but eternity is long. We're going to live forever. We're going to live forever. Thank you, Lord. I mean, just the thought of that blows my mind. And I know sometimes it's hard to see that. Sometimes it's hard to wrap your mind around it and understand that and fully comprehend all of that. Because we're living here, this is all we see. This is all we know. This is what we touch and feel. And that's kind of, we're limited in our thinking. That's why Scripture tells us to walk by faith and not by what you see. Because by what you see, anything you can touch and see are temporal. Are you still with me today? It's temporal. It's going to change. It's going to change. The things you can feel, taste, all those things are temporal. It will change, friend. That's why he says, walk after the Spirit of God. Don't waste time walking after the flesh, the desires, the lust, the things of the flesh. It's going to change. It cannot last forever. Amen. So, you know, I was... You think of Has anybody ever been younger, a little bit in your teenage years? Yeah, there was a day like that. Some of you can't remember that far back. Come on, it was just the other day. How many can still remember junior high? Or, you know, you're not quite in high school. You're not kind of cool. You're still stuck between you. And everything is a disaster. Everything is out of crazy, right? I mean, young kids like that, what are they, 12, 13, 14? It's a vulnerable stage, and we love them, but my goodness, everything is, you know, somebody don't like them. They try to fit in, and it's if they don't get fit in or get, you know, it's the end of the world. Whatever problems come up, oh, my goodness. And you're looking back at them, and come on, you know, oh, no, this is the end. The boyfriend didn't show up or called or something, or, you know, they shouldn't even have them at 13 and 14. But anyway, some do. And so he didn't call, or the girl drops him or what. It's the end of the world for them. They feel like there's no life is not worth living anymore. Come on, help me. I have 6 kids. I've kind of seen one or two things. And I've been one myself, by the way. Don't sit up there looking so holy and pretty. You know how you were back then. And some, unfortunately, hadn't grown out of that. Everything is a disaster. Everything is, it's crazy. And the kid and you're trying to calm down this teenager, you know. And mama can't even go in the room because they shut the door in the room and they just want to be left alone, move out of the country, dig a hole and never come out again. You know, it's just, it's disaster. What happened? She didn't greet me. She didn't write me back or called me or whatever. But it's always so big and it's the end of the world stuff. And there you are, the parent or the mama. Usually mom's great with that. And she goes, honey, come on. It'll be okay. You're going to make it. You're going to find someone else. Or, you know, they're going to like you. And you're going to, no. Oh, my goodness. But you give it some time. And they finally graduate and go to high school or something else. And they meet new friends. Make new, you know, different school maybe, whatever. And life is good. And maybe after a while you talk to them about what happened back then, and they go, I can't even remember that. But you know very well they were going to, you know, it was the end of the world for them. See, sometimes in our life, if we just get God's perspective on things, it'll be so different for us. We'll react differently to things. We won't let things that don't make sense right now that kind of come at us, it will pass. You're going to make it through it. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm here to tell you today, it is not the end. But God has a great future for us. He's got something wonderful in store for us. And I believe that tonight, don't you? Amen. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let me share from John 16, John 16, 33. Jesus said this. He says, listen, I have told you. Read this with me, if you will. Come on, help me participate with me. Let's go. 1, 2, 3, read. I have
told you all this.
So that you may what?
Have peace.
In me. In who?
In me.
I told you all of this stuff so that you may have peace. Chill. Peace. Relax. It's going to be okay. Where? In him. Right? In me, he said. But on earth... It's a different case, right, is what he's saying. Read that with me. Here on earth, you might,
will,
have some trials and
sorrows.
You know, Jesus said that, right? In me, he said, you'll have peace. Now, you're not out of here. You're not absent from this body yet, but he says, if you abide in me, you can endure this stuff. You can make it through. But in this world, there's a whole different story. He says, you will. Somebody say, you will. That's guaranteed, isn't it? I hate to tell you that, but in this world, you will what? Have many trials and sorrows, unfortunately. So what do you do, Pastor? You're not helping me, man. Well, what are you telling me? Here's what's going to happen to me. I'm just, you know, come on, reality check. I just want to make sure you're here with me. But he said, take heart. Be of good cheer. What does he say?
I have overcome.
Because I have what?
Overcome.
What?
Overcome.
One more time. I have?
Overcome.
I have did what? I have?
Overcome.
So if he overcame it with everything that has happened to him, how many know you can overcome anything that the old enemy that the world will throw at you? You can overcome. You can make it. He says, be of good cheer. Don't freak out. I have overcome the world. And if you in me, you'll have that peace. It's going to be okay. Everything is going to be all right. We did some meetings in Jamaica. Anybody ever been to Jamaica? I love Jamaica. Jamaica, me crazy is what you're doing. Jamaica. But everything is iry over there. Everything is iry, iry. It's going to be all right. It's going to be all right. Hakuna Matata. Right? Hakuna Matata. Quit freaking out. Quit taking life so seriously. Put a smile on your face. It confuses the devil every time. A frown, he understands. Misery, he gets that. Ugly, he's familiar. He's the designer of that. But you put a smile on your face, even when you're going through stuff, he's like, what? I like to confuse him. He just hits his head up against the wall somewhere, you know. Oh, thank you, Jesus. In this world, you will have trouble. You'll have trials and sorrows, but be of good cheer, because I have overcome the world. In this world, you're going to face some things. I want to let you know it will happen here in this world. In this world. By this world, by the way, this world is still under a curse. Do you know that? Uh-oh. This world is still under a curse. It hadn't been redeemed yet. There will be one. You read Revelation, it's going to come one day, but it's just not yet. So this world, since Adam's day, is still under a curse. Are you still with me? Because they had everything. I mean, if you think about when the Lord had Adam and Eve, you know, take command over this thing, put them in charge, said, you're going to have dominion over everything. I'm going to know they were in charge of everything, right? On this planet. They were to subdue, they were to rule, to reign. Whatever they said went, whatever they called was. Come on, they named the animals. I believe they were all just around them, and my goodness, he had it made. And he handed it over to the devil, handed it over to Satan, relinquished his authority. And that's why we're in the mess we're in, because of Adam. And I'm going to dig into some other areas later, but I just wanted to leave some of these things with you today. You know, you get people, and that's okay, we've got to be good stewards, but they spend their whole lives trying to save this planet. Save the planet! This planet cannot be saved. There's only one that can change it. Jesus didn't come and die on the cross, lay down his life so he could save the planet. No, you are the ones he came for. You and I are the ones. This planet is in a mess. It's still in a curse. You say, well, I don't believe that. Well, go next time and touch a thorny bush. See what happens to your hand. How many know there were no thorns and thistles then? But because of the curse, oh, now we got to labor hard. We got to dig hard. Women understand this. In child labor, come on. That's the part of that thing that came upon this earth, right? You still with me? Got to labor, got to work by the sweat of your brow. Part of the curse. Animals gone wild. Why do you think lions tear up and devour little Bambi? Why? A part of the curse going on. Nothing natural about that. That was not God's intent. I'm preaching to somebody. That was never God's intent for a venomous scorpion and a spider to hurt people. It's not God's design from the get-go. But because of the curse, you saw all this ugly happening everywhere. I mean, not long down the road, and you see evil so bad that one brother kills another. Part of the curse, friend. So don't expect, you know, there is no paradise here. That's kind of sad. You know, you think of people choosing where they want to live in the U.S. How many know the U.S. has lots of places you can go live and choose to live, right? And for the life of me, I'm thinking, why are people, if you're from Oklahoma, I love you, but what in the world are you doing in Oklahoma when they call the thing Tornado Alley? I mean, that's a giveaway right there. Guess what? We're going to Tornado Alley. I don't want to be anywhere close to Tornado Alley. Yeah, but there's oil in the ground. Okay. But think about it. I mean, if you're from North Dakota, I think you need prayer. What in the world you want to live up there for? It's 60 below, blizzard conditions. It's crazy, but people live there, right? They choose to live there. Nobody forced them over there. They take their families willingly. We're going to live here. It's like, what? What are you thinking? Did you know there are people living in the worst conditions in the world? One of them is the Sahara Desert. Do you know there's folks living there? It's like, dude, you know. Really? 120-something degrees. I mean, whoo. And people live there. We always talk about some things, and, you know, I don't know when the Lord would have us to retire, maybe at 100, I don't know, but or he'll come early, sooner. But I always said, Lord, if you allow me, there's some special places that I would like to live one day. Beaches and stuff, that's kind of me. Others are mountains. So everybody's got their own little taste. And one of the places is I want to introduce you one day to is Cape Town. There's some folks that went with us to South Africa. There's one young lady back there. Would you vouch with me? Cape Town is a beautiful place. Daniel, what would you say?
One of the most beautiful places I've ever seen.
And I've had people, when they look at that, and they go, why did you, Lebanon? Just saying. When you can choose to live anywhere, yet people do. If you live in Alaska, you adapt to the Alaskan way of living, right? You maybe not can, but there are people living up there, and they just adapt. They deal with whatever they're dealing with. People living in San Francisco, knowing the thing's going to fall in the sea any minute now. Right? They over there. Worse than that is the people they hang around with. Why would you do that? And yet they do. So what do you do when you live in Oklahoma or up in those parts? And I love those folks. We've traveled through there, but my goodness. What do? First thing you do is go find a shelter, build a bunker or something, because a tornado is coming to your house one day. Right? You prepare. You adapt. Isn't it? People live in Arizona. It's 300 degrees on a cool day. What do? Lots of suntan, I guess, or sunscreen, or whatever you got to do, right? But they live there. They adapt. They work it out. You live in North Dakota. I don't know what to say to you. I don't know what. I can't help you, man. Just, what are you doing up there? I'm trying to help you, man. But see, wherever we are, it's a natural thing to adapt. And sometimes people live there for several years and they go, you know, I just can't stand this. I got to move somewhere else. We move. We're people that move. We journey. Others, you know, never been out of the state of Tennessee. I'm praying for you too. There are other states around here. You should check it out one day. Pretty amazing. I've had the opportunity to travel to many countries of the world. Seen many places. There's some places I say I could never live there, whether it be the violence or whatever the case may be. But even if many of us, many people around the world don't have a choice, they're just there, and yet they adapt. I'm thinking of people in the Sahara Desert or the Kalahari, the Bushman. He adapts. He makes I don't know how I would survive there, but they do. They find water in a plant out of a. It's amazing. They sleep on the sand. They have little huts. How many has ever seen the Bushman? He doesn't sleep with his head on the ground. Did you know that? Sleeps with his head in his hand. Demonstrate. They lay down for the most part. And that's his pillow. And he'll sleep through the night resting on his hand. Why? Scorpions. It has to crawl up his hand. Or on his body to get in his ears or face or anything like that. So what do? They adapt. They're going to make that work. I said all of that to say this. Here we are in this world, and when things go wrong in our lives, we get blame God. We want to backslide. Why don't we just brace ourselves a little bit? Why don't we just kind of readjust a little bit? Ask the Holy Spirit to help us through the storm. How many know God is, Jesus is right in the boat with you. He's never leaving you. He's always there. Why are you bent out of shape? Why are you going to backslide? Why do you want to blame him? Why do we, all these kind of things. I pray somebody's hearing me. When we do this in the natural out here, how many know you can do this on this planet in the spirit realm? Jesus said, in me. How many know there's a place in him that no matter what is around you, you can have peace? I tell you, not in all circumstances that you pray and God just lifts you out of your problem and there you are. Many a times, or most of the time, he sees you through that thing. Because somewhere in there, there's something I can learn, something I'm going to experience. Somehow, I'm going to experience his love, his grace that I can't experience anywhere else or otherwise. Are you still with me today? God gives us enough grace to move through whatever circumstances. Oh, listen. He knows who you are and how much you can handle. People say so often, I can't handle this. And they do the unthinkable. They take their own lives. They don't see any future. How many know if you're a child of God, God puts nothing more than you can handle on you. And I know sometimes we feel, but this is too heavy to bear. How many know he'll give you grace? He'll walk you through it. He'll hold your hand. He'll carry you. He just don't want you to quit halfway. Don't throw in the towel. I tell you, once you keep, you put your hand in his hand, he'll walk with you every step of the way. David said, through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. That means you're going to go through the valley of the shadow of those things. But he says, I fear no evil, for the Lord is with me. God is with me. Touch somebody so you can make it. There's no time to give up. You have no right to give up. As a child of God, blood bought, washed in the blood. My goodness, heaven is backing you up. All of heaven. He's got angels surrounding you. And you want to quit throwing the towel? No, sir. I'm here to jerk you up again and say, come on. But preacher, you don't know. You've never been through nothing. Come walk a mile in my shoes. Don't you tell other people they don't know anything. Everybody's gone through something. They got a story they can tell. And it may not always look the same, but friend, it's pain. It's suffering. Amen. It's asking, God, where are you at times? Why did this happen? Amen. Amen. But I'm here to tell you, God will help you and walk you through that thing. Isn't that wonderful news? In me, he said, you're going to have peace in this world, unfortunately. And we just have to endure just a little longer. Don't throw, tell the junior high kid, don't jump off the bridge. It's, you're going to make it. You're going to get to another grade and you're going to forget all this trouble. Come on, ladies. You ladies that have given birth, my goodness. I've missed one or two because I've been on revival. We got six kids. But I was there in the room where Elise says, I'm never going to have any kids. That was the first one. And second one, we got however many more. It's like it's the last. A few days later, I just wish I could hold a baby. Isn't it? Come on, ladies. The most horrific thing the pain that you go through. And in that moment, you think it's the end. You're going to die. It's all of this. And in just a moment, as you endure, here comes a little cry. I tell you. Oh, hallelujah. I know I'm not the mama, but I'm a daddy. I'm there, and I don't know what else to do, you know, just stand there and act a fool and then hold a child, and I don't know which way I'm going to break it, you know. But you're learning as you go. You're going to be okay. You're going to make it. Oh, and you come through that, don't you? You've come through that. Right? But what if you have just decided it's too much, I'm just going to die right now? You would miss all the joy if you just hang in a few moments longer. See, that's how God designs this stuff. Don't throw in the towel. Don't give up. In this world, you're going to have trials, tribulations. But be of good cheer. Tell this guy. Elise asked me, who should we put up there? I looked at a few examples and I said, I want this guy. It's like the whole world is, we've all kind of been there. Oh, my goodness. But if I could speak to that picture today, sir, your best days are ahead of you. God has a plan for your life. Don't jump ship. How glory. God has a plan for you. I close. Aren't you glad I close? Amen. You're so gracious. Thank you, Lord. Can we go to Romans as I find a place to close tonight? Romans 8, 16. For his spirit joins with our spirit, right? To affirm what? That we are God's children. Touch somebody, say, I'm a child of God. Touch the other person that's kind of looking like they don't know what you said. Just tell them, I'm a child of God. I am a child of God. I am. That's who I am. You want to know who I am? I'm a child of God. I'm a child of God. Why? For the Spirit of God and my spirit is in unison right there. We agree. Right? His spirit joins with our spirit to affirm that we are children, God's children. Number 17. And since we are his children, we are his what? His heirs. Are you kidding me? I read that, I'm going, and you want to quit? No, sir. If I'm going to be an heir, imagine what I'm going to inherit. In fact, together with Christ, we are heirs of God's glory. But if we are to share his glory, watch out now. How many would like to have God's glory on your life and be the heir of his kingdom and be in the family and woo? No, he says this to you. But if we are going to be and share in his glory, we must also share his sufferings. See, we want to skip this part. We just want the glory. We don't want part of this. But he says, unless you eat of my bread, you have no part of me. If you want to rule and reign with me, see, this thing is going to be restored. If you want to rule and reign with me, you're going to have to suffer with me a little bit. Isn't it? You see that? We want the glory. Sure, I'm an heir. I'm a child of God. I'm in the family. It's good. Well, then he says, if that's what your desire is and if that's who you are, then you must be willing to face some struggles, some suffering, some things. May we finish it with this last one, verse number 18. Yet, what we suffer now is nothing. Nothing. Somebody say nothing. And I'm not minimizing what you're going through, but the Word of God, if he looks at it, he says what you're going through is really nothing compared to what God is for us. Can you receive that today? Yet what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory. Somebody say the glory. Glory. He will reveal to us later. It cannot be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in us. So when I'm looking at these scriptures, it gives me hope. It gives me courage. It gives me assurance. That if I delay, if I hold on in this body just a little longer, I endure, I fight, I pray, I believe, I claim the promises. Listen, we're on this planet. I live here in Tennessee. And in Tennessee, whatever I've mentioned, you get all of the above here. Get a little tornado, you get this, get that, water, sleet, snow, whatever. We get a little bit of everything. I think this last week we might have had the four seasons. Pretty amazing. This is a great state. So you're going to see some snow. Whoa, I'm leaving. I got to run. Or you're going to see some, heat come. Oh, I don't like heat. Boy, you're going to be running back and forth like a chicken with your head cut off. Right? So he says, hey, if you want to win, if you want to reign with me, be willing to endure a little bit. When it's heat and hot and all that, well, just take a layer off, come on. We adjust. We get some sunscreen. We get some whatever you need, right? Buy a hat. Get some air conditioning in your car. Forget it. Fix. Do it. You adjust. You do whatever it takes. When the blizzard comes and the snow is piled this high, what do? You change. You start putting layers on. You just will get you another layer or two and a blanket and a jacket and all that kind of stuff and some boots and you just
What are you doing?
I'm adjusting. I'm going to make it. I'm going to make it through this thing. I'm not going to lay out here. No. Come on, we're people of God. We're children of God. We got a place to go to. We got a destiny. We got inheritance that's coming our way. And I'm not giving up my inheritance because I feel a pain and I go through stuff and people leave me and this and that happens. No. I'm going to be stronger than that because I can endure. Jesus endured the cross. How many know the cross was very severe? Why? Can you tell me why he endured the cross? What does the Bible say? For the what? The joy that was set before him, he endured. It would have been a tough one if there was no joy, if there was no price, if there was no reason to endure. It would have been in vain. But he looked ahead and he saw you and I and he saw us and he says, I've got to endure. There's a son, there's Michael, there's somebody here that I need saving. I'm going to shed my blood for them. I'm going to endure. There are children right here. How many know he saw you in eternity's eye? And that's why he endured, for the joy that was set. What was the joy, you and I? That we would be redeemed. We would be washed in his blood. The curse of Satan upon our lives would be washed away, would be forever. I mean, we are made righteous. The joy that was set before him. And so tonight, ladies and gentlemen, you and I can endure whatever we're going through. However hard, trouble, whatever it is. I just say that. And I want you to receive that by faith. For the joy that is set before us, there is a price. There's heaven to gain. There's a hell to shun. There's a victory. Stand to your feet all over this house. Come on, give God a praise. Give God some praise. Give God some praise in the house. Lord, we bless you. Come on, just worship him and praise him. Father, we give you glory. Our mouth will worship you. Our tongue will confess you as Lord. We lift up your name. There will be forever a praise in my mouth. God, even when I go through the storms of life, even when my boat is rocked, oh, and I feel like I'm drowning, it's taking on water, yet I will raise my hands and praise you and bless your name. Oh, hallelujah. We say with the psalmist, Lord, woe with the struggles we're going through. My soul is vexed and going through all of this. Yet I will bless the Lord. I will praise you because of your loving kindness, your unfailing love. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, Spirit of God, lift each of your children tonight to a new place in you. God, the storm is almost over. We're going to the other side. We've all ministered and heard about the boat in the middle of the ocean with Jesus in it. Oh, it takes on water. The storm is boisterous. But he said, we're going to the other side. And as long as he's with me, I will fear no evil. I'm going to the other side. We're going to make it in the name of Jesus. Somebody give the Lord praise in the house. Give him praise and glory. Hallelujah.